We are the clay. You are the potter. We are all works in your hands. You have a plan for our lives. A purpose. A future. You promise you won't leave us. And when we face the tests and trials, you are there. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future.
Please stand. or not. I have not heard back from the choir director, so stay tuned. I will be trying to be in touch with them to see if they are coming. Also, I think we have a special day coming up. Phyllis Deweese's birthday is coming up, and this afternoon, we're going to have a big old birthday party for her. I believe in the fellowship hall from 2 to 4.
Okay. Hold that away a little bit. The mission pennies, they're going around. For those of you that are new to our church, this is just something we do to help raise some money for our mission work. Just change your pockets. And this month, they're going to be going to towards expenses for vacation Bible school this summer. So that's what those mission pennies are doing. Red Cross Blood Drive, Thursday, May 10th, Friday, May 11th, in our fellowship hall. So if you want to help with the canteen or make cookies or whatever, get over to Charlene. She's in charge of that part of it. Spring banquet for the women is going to be on Monday, May 21 at 6:30. Covered dish dinner. So you want to partake of that, well, that's the day to do it. Our scholarship deadlines are come and gone on some of them. The one we've got left is the applications for the estate grant scholarships are due June 1. We're still collecting water for the Relay for Life in June. You notice we've got some cases of bottled water down there by the office. If you'd like to contribute to that, we'll do so at the office. We've got a Today's Concerns link is doing lunch and shopping in Topeka on May the 15th, Tuesday. They're going to leave the church parking lot at 8 a.m. and travel to Topeka in the church van. And please bring $5 to help with the cost of gas and let Linda know by Monday, May 14th, if you're going to go. And it says Genesis to Revelation Bible study will not meet in May. So we'll start back up June 18th. Are there any other announcements that we brought up this morning?
I do want to announce everybody's going to want to be here next Sunday for Mother's Day. I am planning something special.
Something special for Mother's Day. Okay. Any other announcements? I know, Phyllis, you can't be 80 years old.
I sure am.
You sure are? Okay, well, happy birthday to Phyllis.
Actually, I was a bit at 8 o'clock in the evening. That's the reason I'm not a morning person.
That's not a reason you're not, never have been, huh? Okay. Any other announcements? If not, stand up past peace for me.
Thank you. Jesus loves me. We'll be singing all three verses.
through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. This day, I present Samuel James Ebrahim for baptism this day. I ask now the family these questions. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness? Reject the evil powers of the world and repent of your sin, so say I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God has given you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? And so say I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, say, I do. Okay, now I ask the congregation, will you nurture this child in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, he may be guided to accept God's grace for himself, to profess his love and faith openly, and to lead a Christian life. Okay, now if you'll go over to page 35. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include this person now before you in your care?
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ.
We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness
that they may grow in the trust of God and be found faithful in His service to others. We will pray for
throughout his life, that dying and being raised with Christ, he may share in his final victory. All praise
to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen.
Jesus saves.
financial concern, though. So I want to put out to the congregation that if you feel led to give towards helping the custodial position cost of upping 10 more hours a week, if you can give towards designated giving, stating custodian, that way we will be able to make this happen. Also, if you know somebody interested in a 30-hour a week position, let us here seen know. Thank you.
Okay. Any other joys and concerns this morning?
My honey finally graduated from college, so we're done with that chapter in her life. And then if we can put a prayer up for Randy Finley, he's got a really bad infection in his leg, so just healing for that.
Do that. Congratulations, Wade. Considering as much as he does in the community, full-time job, full-time family man, and complete college education. Anybody else this morning have a joy or concern?
Last Sunday afternoon, my mother called and she said, "Hey, by the way, your cousin Tim just went to St. Luke's today and got a new heart." We were unaware that he was on a heart transplant list since January. He received a new heart on Sunday, last Sunday, and they anticipate that he'll be dismissed on Tuesday. So things are going very well for him. He's only 46.
Keep in our heart. Yes, Phyllis.
I'm just so delighted to be here amongst my church family. All of you folks, I just love because you made me feel so welcome when I came here. And I love being in church and close to God. And everybody come and have a bite of cake and sacrament. Please, no gifts. Just your presence is all I want. Thank you.
Just a word from the Lord. Psalm 122:1 that said, "I rejoice with those who said, let us go to the house of the Lord." It is good to be here.
All right, anyone else this morning?
If not, then let's go, Lord, in a moment of silent prayer. Some of our family. illness, uncertainty, job loss, and the list goes on. We come and we lift them up before you in your mighty presence, and we pray, my God, for your intervention. As God, we come forth and we lift up that prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we are going to have a special music from the Methodist, and also let us prepare to offer up our tithes and our offerings to the Lord.
I'm the road.
families. We pray that they will be a blessing unto your sight and use according to your will. Amen.
If you will, you remain standing for our scripture reading this morning. Scripture comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 15, verses 9 through 17, which is a continuation of last Sunday's scripture, which was about the vine and the branches. John 15, 9 through 17. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands, so that you may love one another. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I want to start out by asking, what does it take to forge a friendship? Well, I believe the answer depends on who you are. Take, for instance, you are into sports. Friendships might involve mutual like of sports. Maybe your friends that play football or basketball or soccer with you. Maybe there are three girlfriends who share on shopping trips, maybe a coffee every week together. Maybe seven-year-old boys, they are friends because they all like Spider-Man. It depends on mutual likes. But what if you can't find somebody who you can be friends with? What do you do? Well, there is a person out there called Rosenbaum who's come up with a solution. You can go to www.rentafriend.com and put in, and if you're getting ready and you want to go to the movies but you don't want to go alone, you can rent a friend. They will send someone out to you. And more than that, if you have friendship to give, you can get online and pick yourself up to be rented. How awesome is that? Who wants to sign up for it? What? No takers? What's wrong with this picture? I thought everybody's hand would go up in the air. We all want more friends, right? And we all want to be friends with everybody, right? I might get much of a feedback today. Well, the truth is, all this wants real friends. No matter how you might feel about Rosenbaum's idea of rent a friend, the fact is, we all want real friends in our lives. We want meaningful connections. That these real friends, meaningful harder to come by. Yet, in John chapter 15, Jesus is in the middle of this farewell discourse. It's a series of teachings that he gives to the disciples in the waning hours of his ministry. It's aimed at preparing them for the time when he will not be with them any longer. And so we find this section where Jesus speaks to the kind of connection he longs to see between the disciples and others, those who claim to be obedient disciples. He says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no more than that, than this, than someone to lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you." It may sound simple, but this is Jesus' desire for the church, this community, to be forgiven and faith-filled disciples, to be a place of true loving friendship. Jesus' command is that this place become one place in the world, if not the premier place, where we all crave to be in loving connection with one another. So let that sink in for just a moment. Christ wants us all to be friends, not rented friends, not service level friends, not diet soda type friends, but instead, true, loving, life-giving, deeply satisfying, intimate, connected friends. So, how do we go about that? What does it take to be a true friend? A lot. But I want to present two things that needs to be present in order to forge a strong friendship. The first is sharing. True friends share with one another. In verse 15, Jesus goes on to say, "No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you." I have made known to you. What's amazing about this thing is that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Savior of the whole world, refers to us, his disciples, as friends. And the reason he considers his followers friends is because of what he has shared. They are not servants waiting on him. Instead, he has waited on them and he has shared with them his teaching, his commandments. The fact that God is reconciling the world, reconciling you and me to God through the work of Christ on the cross, and doing this free of charge, no strings attached, this reveals the true heart of God. We are God's friends, and he loves us. Secondly, to be a friend involves sacrifice. Jesus could not be clearer on this. And a true community of love, the kind of love and friendship that he wants for us, friends will be readily and regularly willing to give up their lives for one another. I'm not talking about giving up your lives through death like Christ did for us. I am saying put your needs second to your friends. Making true sacrifices and knowing what they need in their lives A true friend is someone who keeps your preferences in mind, who passes on what they want in order to offer you what you need, and who refuses to fight for his or her rights, but when it comes to you, aims to serve your interests if they are in accordance with God's. Okay? That's the kicker. If they are in accordance with God's, not theirs. Now, a true friend will also stand in the way when it is going against God's morals, going against the scriptures, and how we are to live our lives in Christ. So I want to ask, are we friends? Are we friends with one another? Look around. Look to your right, look to your left, look to your front, look to your back. Are we truly friends? Are we sharing? Are we sacrificing with one another? Do we love one another, and do we embody the kind of connection that Christ has modeled for us, and even for each of us to embody? If we were to think about it fully, I would sadly say that in the most part, mostly, we would have to say, no, not all the time. These things take work. But the good thing is we are on a road towards Christian perfection. And as John Wesley taught us, we are on that road to Christian perfection. We hope to get it in this lifetime. We might not, but that is okay, because it is a path that we keep driving down and working towards. In verse 9, Jesus gives us the invitation to abide in his love. We are to abide. We are to place ourselves in that love. We are to live in it and not stray. Because what a friend we have in Jesus, because he is the full embodiment of love variance. That is pure love. We are all forgiven. We are all welcomed to abide in Christ's love. That's what we need to recognize. So we need to think of the ills in this place. That if we are a true friendship, that all the ills, all the griefs that are there will be silenced by this love. Think of the depression among us. If you recognize you have true friendship in Christ, the loneliness and the despair will disappear. Think of how through sacrifice, the pile of bills among one family and our friendships gathered here as a body of Christ, how it can disappear. Think of how the pursuit of another's interests can lead to fights. But when we are coming together in true friendship, the bickering and the fighting is silenced. Think about the peace that Christ brings us as our friend, flowing from us, out of these walls, out of these doors, into the community therefore. You see, we are a people who crave community. God created us to crave community, to want to be around others. And in that, we have power and persuasion, because people want to be around us. That is, if we shine forth joy and love instead of hate and anger and despair. When we show love to others, people will want to be in community with us and they will want to be your friend. So as you go forth from here, abide in Christ and join together in strength as the body of Christ. On that night in which Christ gave himself upon the cross, he took the bread. He broke it. He gave it to disciples and said, "Take, eat, all of you. This is my body which is broken for you for the forgiveness of sins." When the meal was over, he took the cup. He blessed it. He gave it to disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood poured out for the new covenant. Drink this in remembrance of me for the forgiveness of sins." Let us pray. Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us who are gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. May they be for us the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. And may we be filled with your grace and mercy, and be your hands and feet to deliver your message. In Christ's name, amen. Those who are assisting may come forward. sanctify us through this holy meal. In Christ's name, amen. I invite you to stand and let's sing together, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus."